Hello and welcome back to the shop and Charlemagne's Clock, where we've been talking about issues relating to the Boeing company and its many woes and some things that can be done about it. We've gone over just how bad the situation is at a very high level. And we have laid out some easy fixes that can be done for basically no cost within the company, just by getting three words straight. If people working for the company, especially the leadership, would start to understand and model the difference between the good kind of pride and the one that's part of the seven deadly sins or the root of them. If they would understand that this word manage is problematic in some of the mental models that it creates for us, and that it's really one, the role of being a leader in a business or anything else is one about being in service. You're there to enable the people doing the work to do their best, to produce something that everyone can feel good about and that will meet a market and find some happy customers. Finally, understanding that this word lean was a mistake, and that a much better term to describe what we're after is choreograph, making things flow in a seamless fashion, such that the chaos and extra resources required to support that chaos is minimized. And then we moved on to larger things, things that will require support from the broader community, meaning Congress. Boeing is headed toward a bailout. It's been self-liquidating. It went bankrupt sometime back around 2012, per generally accepted accounting principles, because it was carrying on its books and still is the development costs for the 787 program, which have no value. They should have been expensed when it was realized that program accounting was dead, which was in 2012, or thereabouts. Finally, so we started to look at what the price of that bailout should be, and pointed out that gee, we ought to recharter it. This idea of having a charter issued by the state of Delaware, which doesn't police its charters, and basically is just in the business of granting corporate charters so that it's trivially easy to charter anything you want and remain anonymous or whatever. But they basically have no rules they enforce. Slight exaggeration, but not much. And what we should do is charter it as an American corporation and require, as a part of that chartering process, a whole new approach to the corporation. One that recognizes the obvious thing that Peter Drucker pointed out back in 1946, sort of like the little boy shouting, "Hey, the emperor has no clothes." Drucker said, "Hey, by the way, this corporation thing is now so big that it's one of our major institutions. It's the way we organize our society. It's right up there with government, religion, and our educational institutions, if not larger." Stating the obvious, and then starting in 1957, then with the publication of the book in 1960, Douglas MacGregor, working at the Sloan School, which was founded by Drucker's mentor and a sponsor of what went into this book, Alfred P. Sloan at MIT. Sloan was a CEO of General Motors, and he funded this school at MIT to study management. And MacGregor, in a talk there and then in this book, started to explain that, modern society requires us to create an environment that is respectful of the human being. That the frankly Stone Age approach to things, this command and control system that we've been using for years, is inappropriate. And in fact, it produces shoddy products at lower quality. And that if we would simply show some respect to our fellow human beings in the workplace and take an attitude that management is about enablement, that we would do a lot better and we'd be happier as a result. And McGregor called them Theory X and Theory Y. Adding to that, as it became clear that several Japanese companies, including most especially Toyota, were racing right by us, Daichi Ono, the chief engineer who had helped develop much of Toyota's methodology, and then one of the he wasn't ambassador, but he worked in the Japanese consulate in Washington, D.C. Masaki Imai wrote a book trying to explain part of the cultural element. He called it Kaizen. He didn't go all the way. He did not get into the nature of the 1949 strike and labor agreement at Toyota. They pretty much carefully avoid that topic, which we'll talk about another time. But William Auchi, also at MIT, went and showed how this idea of good change, Kaizen, continuous improvement, when coupled with the theory Y concept of McGregor, would become something much more powerful. So highly recommend reading Auchi. He makes some very valuable observations about the power of these things when brought together. So if we were to bail out Boeing when the time comes, we should set up a chartering process. This is what I'm suggesting. We should set up a chartering process that creates a new kind of American corporation that somehow enshrines these ideas and strongly encourages the bailed out company to reform itself and get in line with the program. So what would that look like? So what would it look like? Well, let me tell another story. In the year 1907, a bridge was under construction across the St. Lawrence River at the city of Quebec. It collapsed, killed several people. There was a lot of alarm. It was deemed an important project, so they got going again. And then in 1916, it collapsed again and killed a bunch more people. Total of 88 lives lost in the two collapses. This led to a decision by the Canadian government, which was quickly copied by governments in the United States, primarily at the state level, to require professional engineers, civil engineers, to be licensed professionals. Critical infrastructure projects had to be signed off in the permitting process by a qualified licensed engineer. In subsequent years, after 1916, the idea of licensing critical professions spread. People in many professions saw it as a way of protecting their reputations and establishing needed standards for their particular businesses. So people in the professions campaigned to have licensing requirements imposed upon themselves. They saw this as an important step forward. And it was basically moving in the direction that the legal and medical fields had established for themselves in previous centuries. This movement, the professional licensing movement, picked up even more steam after the beginning of the Great Depression in 1929. At that time, the accounting profession moved into licensing, and very quickly other professions followed as well. One of the things that we can do when we recognize that a large corporation that is bankrupt and is asking for a bailout, and we think it's too big to let fail because there are just too many interests involved in the communities, the products, the people involved, it's a too big to fail situation, is that key managerial roles should become licensed professions. We should demand that. People involved should want that. There should be a canon of ethics. And there should be standards for professional quality, work quality, product quality. So when a leader is doing something or going about their daily activities, it should, those activities should be consistent with the canon of ethics that has been established for their particular profession. Clearly, we need to do this for positions such as CEO, Chief Operating Officer, Chairman of Board, all board members themselves, basically anybody who is a member of the executive committee, the council that works with the Chief Operating Officer to see to the daily operations of a business. These should be licensed professions with a canon of ethics that recognizes the totality of the fiduciary responsibilities, which is their privilege. Their privilege to serve. Leadership is a service role. This can't be stressed enough. It's back to this business of humility and the right kind of pride. What Simon Sinek stressed in his book and his talks, Leaders Eat Last. It's what Alan talked about in his working together about taking everybody along. The role of leadership is nurturing the team. It's what McGregor was talking about with his theory why, with what William Ouchie was talking about with his idea of commitment, that management must demonstrate that it is committed to the welfare of the organization and its future, and which implies the future of the employees and the access to its products and services by its customers, the health and welfare of the communities in which it operates. That's that level of commitment. There's a fiduciary responsibility that is vastly more broad than just making sure that people who have decided to invest in the firm are getting a reasonable return on their investment. So, summing up, the disaster that befell Boeing when the Jack Welch culture of greed and decapitalization swept through the company, beginning with the introduction of Harry Stonecipher and than Jim McNerney. That disaster need not have been in vain. The lives lost, the more than 360 people who lost their lives as a result of the decapitalization and the introduction of leadership and engineering leadership and competence into the company. That need not have been in vain if we seize upon the opportunity of the need to recapitalize it, to bail it out, to create a new kind of chartered company in the United States, a new kind of charter that demands that leadership be a professional calling, that people who presume to wear the hat of board member or CEO or chief operating officer or chief financial officer or any of the other key positions in the C-suite, that those become licensed professionals with a code of ethics appropriate to the leadership of a company that touches so many people and companies. At the very least, there should be a requirement that such a company would have a statement of principles and that it would regularly report on its performance against those statements of principle. And William Auchi's Theory Z, 1981 book, and he was also working at the Sloan School. It's interesting. GM should have been paying attention to the work they were sponsoring, but perhaps they are now. In the appendix, he provides the statements of principle that had been adopted by four different companies, Eli Lilly, HP, Hewlett-Packard, Intel, and Rockwell. And I want to read to you a passage from Hewlett-Packard's statement. It's about profits, which will really bring into focus this whole business of fiduciary responsibility and the how much more broadly that responsibility is than just looking to the Wall Street greed machine. Number one principle deals with profit. Objective: to achieve sufficient profit to finance our company growth and to provide the resources we need to achieve our other corporate objectives. In our economic system, the profit we generate from our operations is the ultimate source of funds we need to prosper and to grow. It is the one absolutely essential measure of our corporate performance over the long term. Again, they're saying money, profit, is the measure of how well you're doing. It's not the objective. It's the measure of how well you're performing against your other objectives. So you need to be performing well because you need that profit in order to invest in your future. Only if we continue to meet our profit objective can we achieve our other corporate objectives. Our long-standing policy has been to reinvest most of our profits and depend on this reinvestment, plus funds from employee stock purchases and other cash flow items, to finance our growth. This can be achieved if our return on net worth is roughly equal to our sales growth rate. We must strive to reach this goal every year without limiting our efforts to attain our other objectives. Money is the measure, it is not the objective. Money is the measure, it is not the objective. hopefully the failure of the Boeing company and what I hope is its rebirth by a transformation imposed upon it through a bailout process. Hopefully that can be something greater, not just a bailout of Boeing, but it can provide us with a model of what good corporate governance would look like. It would have a canon of ethics and licensed professionals whose position, whose personal licenses require them to be adherent to their canon of ethics. That the company then be investing its profits in its future, that it be visionary. If we did this, I really think it would reflect the best of us. So that's the opportunity that this mess presents. It could turn out to be a good thing if we choose to make it so. Thank you very much for spending this time with me. I hope it's been I hope it's lived up to your expectations. Back here again sometime in the future, and we'll dig into another topic of interest in technology today and ethics and issues and opportunities. In the meantime, if you like what you hear, press the like button. Please subscribe and buy the book, Tao of IT by me, available on my website, craigdupler.com, or Amazon and eBay. Thank you very much. Take care.